here, the Packard 12C financial calculator is a pretty handy, pretty sophisticated tool. In fact, you can do net present value and internal rate of return calculations on this calculator. And this video will walk you through using the blue keyboard and the gold keyboard to make those calculations. First of all, big picture, why do we need to know net present value? Why do we need to know internal rate of return? Remember, on a company's balance sheet, on the right-hand side is what it owes, and then the difference between what it owns on the left-hand side and what it owes on the right-hand side is the equity in the business. And all this capital on the right-hand side of the balance sheet has a cost. We'll calculate the after-tax cost of money on the right-hand side. That's called the weighted average cost of capital. And we'll need to earn at least that much when we put new assets on the left-hand side. So I'm going to try to remember to put a link in the description of this video that'll send you to a short video about calculating weighted average cost of capital. But big picture, we're trying to put assets on the balance sheet that earn more than what our capital costs us. When we're doing net present value and internal rate of return calculations, we're going to use the blue keyboard, specifically the GCFO, the GCFJ, and the GNJ. This CFO is for the initial cash flow. This is for each of the future cash flows. And if a future cash flow repeats, we'll use the NJ. It isn't 100% necessary that you know this, but what the calculator is going to do is it's going to take that information that we give it, and it's going to store, for instance, that CFO data is in this register here, 0. The first cash flow will be in the register 1, register 2, register 3, etc. And if we go past 10, it'll use 0.0 for 11, 0.1 for 12, etc. And even if we run out of those storage registers, the calculator is going to use the FV as kind of like a last stop for memory storage. It's also going to use this N key to index all the things that we're doing, and you only need to know all that information if you ever have to go back and change anything. Okay, let's pretend like we figured out that our weighted average cost of capital is 8%. Our money on the right-hand side of our balance sheet costs us 8%. We want to enter into projects, we want to make investments, we want to do things on the left-hand side of the balance sheet that return more than 8%. So let's put this hypothetical cash flow into our calculator. I'm going to hit F clear registers. Technically, you don't have to do that because the calculator is supposed to be smart enough to only use the new stuff that you put in, but I just like to start with a clean slate every time. So $130,000 is the initial cash flow out. So we're going to change the sign to make that cash out, and then we're going to hit GCF0. So we told the calculator the initial cash outflow is $130,000. Next is $7,000 in, $7,000 GCFJ. It doesn't repeat. $10,000 out. So we'll change the sign on it, GCFJ. And so the facts are usually we buy a new machine, and after the first year we have to remodel it, so we have to invest some cash. Then we get $20,000 3 years in a row, so $20,000 there. I could hit $20,000 CFJ, $20,000 CFJ, $20,000 CFJ, but there's a shortcut key. I can just hit 3G. NJ, and that tells the calculator that this is a grouped cash flow, a repeating cash flow, and it repeats three times. Next, we get $12,000 in, then $8,000 out, and $178,500 in. Let's check ourselves. Let's see what the cash flow at 1 is. So we'll hit recall 1, and sure enough, there's $7,000. So like I say, the calculator uses the memory registers over here to store these cash flows. And if it runs out of memory registers over here as a last ditch effort, it'll use the FV key to store one final cash flow. Let's plug in the interest rate, 8i, and then hit F NPV. $11,429. Since it has a positive net cash flow, we do this project. Doing this project adds $11,429 worth of value to our company. In case it helps you, what the calculator did was it took the initial cash flow, which was a negative number, and added to it the present value of each of the future cash flows and gave us the net present value. We could also have found the internal rate of return. That's the discount rate at which the present value of the future cash flows is exactly equal to the initial cash outlay, or what the project earns. Let's hit FIRR, and it tells us it's 9.37. Since that's more than 8%, we do it. So the good news about the IRR calculations, it's easy to understand. Even a marketing major gets that if your money costs you 8% and you invest it to earn 9.37, that project is a go. The bad news is if there's changes of signs here in these cash flows, there may be multiple solutions to the equation whereby the I is the right amount to make the future cash flows have a present value exactly equal to the initial cash flow. And the other one is that it can lead to some misleading decisions on mutually exclusive projects. You might undertake a smaller project that has a higher rate of return, but that means you're not getting as much value dollar-wise added to your company. If you want to change one of the cash flows, you simply look at whichever one it is. Like recall one here, if you wanted to change that to $8,000, you would simply hit $8,000, store that in one. If you need to change the number of repetitions for a cash flow, first set the end for the cash flow previous, then hit the G and J key for the correct amount of repetitions. All right, let's see if we can check our work using Excel. First, let's check our IRR calculation. There's nothing tricky about that. In Excel, it's equals IRR, and then you designate the values, close it up, and there's our 9.37%. Now let's check the NPV, and that's just a tiny bit trickier. We'll tell Excel equals NPV. It wants to know a rate. We'll hit 0.08, and then it wants to know the values. We'll tell it these values. We'll close up the parentheses, and lo and behold, we get the wrong answer. Because Excel assumes that this first cash flow is received at the end of the first period. So we've got to take this whole answer here, and what we've got to do is we've got to move it forward one period. And I like to do that by multiplying it times 1 plus the interest rate, which is 1 plus 0.08. And so hopefully when I hit enter, we get exactly the right net present values. So when you go to check yourself in Excel, remember that Excel assumes that that first cash flow is made at the end of the first period, when in fact it's made at the beginning of the first period. Hope that helps.